بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. الحمد لله وشكر لله. الحمد لله على نعمة الإسلام. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم. The 6th of Rajab commemorates the passing away of Sayyidina al-Imam al-Habib Ahmad bin Hassan al-Attas radiyallahu anhum. He's from the Mashaykh of Habib Ahmad Mashur al-Haddad radiyallahu anhum. Bin Sheikh Abdul Rahman al-Saghaf al-Kabir. Bin Sheikh Muhammad Mawla Dawila. Bin Sheikh Ali Mawla al-Darak. Bin Alawi al-Ghuyur. Bin Faqih al-Muqaddam Muhammad bin Ali. بن محمد صاحب مرباط بن علي خالي قسم بن علوي بن محمد صاحب الصومة بن علوي بن عبيد الله بن الإمام المهاجر إلى الله أحمد بن عيسى بن محمد النقيب بن علي الأريدي بن جعفر صادق بن محمد الباكر بن علي زين العابدين بن حسين السبت بن علي بن أبي طالب وفاطمة Al-Zahra, the daughter of our master, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the seal of the Prophet. The mother of Habib Ahmad bin Hassan al-Attas radiallahu anhu, she was the Sayyida Sharifa Hababa Salma, the daughter of Sheikh bin Abdallah al-Attas. The life of Habib Ahmad bin Hassan al-Attas radiallahu anhu, he was born in Hurayda in 1257 Hijri, which corresponds to 1841 of the English calendar. And while he was an infant, he went blind. But Allah opened his inner sight, his basira, and at a young age, he would inform people of the ghaib, of the unseen. And his upbringing was supervised by his grandfather, Habib Abdullah, who began teaching him the Quran at the age of 5. The Arif Billah, Habib Saleh bin Abdullah al-Attas, radiallahu anhum, he oversaw his spiritual development. And one Friday morning, Habib Ahmad at that time was maybe 5 or 6 years old, and he was playing in the street. Habib Saleh passes him by and tells him, put on the best of clothes and go to pray the Friday prayer. And then he recites a verse of the Quran to him from Surah Al-Hajj, verse 32, that if someone venerates the sacred things of Allah, this is truly a sign of piety in the heart. This is the first verse of the Quran that Habib Ahmad received from Habib Saleh. He immediately went home, he bathed, he dressed, and he went to the Friday prayer. So from that young age, Habib Saleh planted in his heart a longing for Allah, an intense longing, and a desire to travel the path to him. He had an immense attachment to Habib Saleh. And whenever Habib Ahmad would hear that he's coming to Hurayda, he would go far, he would go beyond the boundaries and outskirts of Hurayda to meet him and spend all his time in his company. There was an occasion when Habib Ahmad complained to Habib Saleh about waswas, the whisperings in the heart, in his early days. Until one day, Habib Ahmad stood next to Habib Saleh, and Habib Saleh gently whispered to him, Allahu Akbar. Those words of Habib Saleh penetrated the heart of Habib Ahmad bin Hassan al-Attas, and they removed all the traces of these whisperings. Yeah. He would travel and study with Habib Saleh in a place called Amd, and it is there that Habib Ahmad bin Hassan al-Attas radiallahu anhu, he received his fath, his opening. And in the early days of Habib Ahmad, they were characterized by immense spiritual striving. It is said that he would turn the day into the night and the night into the day, meaning not from a paranormal or supernatural point of view, but in the sense that he would pray the Fajr or the Zohar prayer with the wudu of Isha that he had from the night before. So he would make fresh wudu for Isha, and he would still have maintained that same wudu. He would have it for Fajr and Zohar. Habib Saleh would bring dates and sit with him and make sure that they ate together. Habib Ahmad bin Hassan radiallahu anhu, the second main sheikh he had was Habib Abu Bakr bin Abdullah al-Attas, who gazed upon him from a very early age. Habib Abu Bakr would test Habib Ahmad by keeping him waiting outside his house for many, many, many hours before finally allowing him to enter. Habib Ahmad says, once I asked Habib Abu Bakr for a written ijazah from him. And then Habib Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu responds by asking him, would he prefer the ijazah of the paper or the ijazah in his heart? Habib Ahmad, of course, he chose the latter for the ijazah to be in his heart. Habib Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he wrote once to Habib Ahmad saying, persevere until the leaves and the thorns fall away and what is left is the fruit. After some time, Habib Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he announced and proclaimed and said that Habib Ahmad bin Hassan al-Atas radiallahu anhu is the heir of his ancestor Habib Umar bin Abdurrahman al-Atas radiallahu anhu, whose laqab is Qutb al-Anfas. In 1274 Hijri, while still in his youth, Habib Ahmad, he travels to Makkah to perform the Hajj and visit the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he settled in Makkah in 1275 to seek knowledge. And the Shaykh al-Islam Sayyid Ahmad bin Zaini Dahlan radiallahu anhu, he took him under his wing and oversaw his studies. And under his tutelage, he finished the memorization of the Quran, he mastered its verdant readings and deepened his knowledge of the Islamic sciences. He ordered him to leave his awrad and focus on his studies. Habib Ahmad obeyed, and leaving with great reluctance all of his awrad, including the ratib al-atas of Habib Umar bin Abdurrahman. But such was a concern of Habib Umar bin Abdurrahman al-atas radiallahu anhu, that he many times repeatedly he would come to Habib Ahmad and order him to read the ratib al-atas until he did so. Said Ahmad Dahlan, he would greatly honor Habib Ahmad and foresaw the rank that he would reach. And he wanted him to succeed in teaching and also to lead the prayer in the Masjid al-Haram. But Habib Ahmad refused, following in the footsteps of the predecessors of the Bani Alawi, who preferred not to be known and not to have any fame or popularity. Habib Ahmad also studied at the hands of two other scholars of the two sanctuaries. Amongst them is Habib Muhammad bin Hussein al-Habshi radiallahu anhu and Habib Fadl bin Alawi Mawla al-Dawila radiallahu anhu. So then in 1281, he returns back to Huraida and spends the rest of his life in the way of his Salaf, of the Bani Alawi, calling people to Allah, Dawah and Tabligh, spreading knowledge and rectifying the society of that time. At that time, Huraida and the surrounding valleys were characterized by ignorance, illiteracy, tribal violence and un-Islamic practices and customs. Habib Ahmad bin Hassan would pay for teachers to come to the town of Huraida and surrounding areas of Tarim to teach the ordinary people their religious obligations. They would teach them to read, to write, to recite the Quran. He paid for a mu'allima, a female scholar from Tarim who had studied at the hands of the great Arif Billah Habib Ahmad bin Umar bin Samit radiallahu anhu. She came to Huraida to teach the women. He provided her with a house and a salary, and he would send her to other towns to teach the women folk. He oversaw the education of the children and would at times invite them to his house, ask them about their progress. He would give the children sweets, pens and paper and give money to their teachers. His mastery of jurisprudence allowed him to find opinions that allowed the common people to practice their religion with ease. He always encouraged his students to refer to the books of the early scholars as well. And he would look at how his predecessors amongst the Ba'alawi Imams had acted upon them and follow in their example. In Huraida, robbery and fighting was a common occurrence. Until Habib Ahmad radiallahu anhu, he designated the heart of the city a safe haven. And he managed to get all the tribes in Hadramaut to agree to this. And he rid the town of un-Islamic practices, particularly those associated with weddings. He not only saved the living, but he also established a program of recitation of the Quran for the people that have passed away, similar to programs that are placed in Tarim and in other towns in Hadramaut. And he ensured that the town's religious endowments were properly preserved and recorded. He expended his own personal wealth and his time and used that time to resolve tribal feuds in the region. And he was regarded as the main negotiator in Hadramaut. Whenever he heard that trouble had occurred or there was an instance of trouble, he would immediately rush to the area to find a solution and to create reconciliation between the peoples. And sometimes months would go past, he would travel between one tribe and another, so that, he was a negotiator, a person who was a professional, you could say, in dispute resolution. And he'd spend his wealth and time repairing flood channels and dams in a region which was prone to flash floods. Although most of his time was in Hurayda and the surrounding regions, he would make regular trips to other cities in Hadhramaut to visit other scholars and blessed places.